Thank you for joining us for our webinar this afternoon on automating package builds and self-serve password resets. Tunis, can you go to the next slide? Briefly, my name is Michael Garrett. I will be the host and the MC for the session today. I'm the president and owner of Team Kane. I'm pleased to be joined by Tunis Alberts. Tunis is with our European partner, Forza Consulting, and is a D1 technology consultant there, and will be doing the majority of the presentation. Thanks, Tunis. Next slide. What we're going to be covering off today is the Pac-Man solution, which is the technical change management automation solution from Forza, talking about the typical process around this for package builds versus automated, the features, the process flow, do an actual demo of it, and talk a little bit about the benefits. And then also self-serve password reset, which is a user self-serve password reset. So why should you be considering it? How does it work? Bit of the architecture, demo on it. I'll talk about the reporting that's part of it, and then the benefits from it. So next slide, and I think we're officially over to you to carry on from here. Tunis?
Thank you, Mike. Welcome all to this webinar about two of our products that we sell. The first one is Pac-Man. The name may suggest this is about automating your package build, but it's a little bit more than that. It's also about automating the JDE object lifecycle management. So let's take a look at a typical change management process that you see in JDE Advance. So from a development point of view, we have a developer that is changing objects, and when he's changed, when the objects are changed and he's finished his work, he will then request a package build so the package can deploy the changes that he's made to the development enterprise server, so the testing can be done in the development path code. As you can see, there are the red bordered rectangles with the activities that typically a CNC person needs to do in order to build and deploy the same package. But we're not only talking about DV, we're also talking about PY path code, PD path code, or maybe even additional path codes that have been created, like an acceptance or a QA path code. And as you can see, there are a lot of activities that a CNC person manually needs to do to allow the packages the changes to be developed in DV to be brought all the way to production. And all these activities that you see here are the activities that can be automated using Pac-Man. So it's not only the process of building and deploying packets, but also the promotion of the projects in the flow from development up to production. So what are the features and functions of Pac-Man? Pac-Man really assembles the packages based on OMW projects. So the developer will bring a project into a selection status for Pac-Man, and Pac-Man will then pick up the projects in that selection status and use the objects that are on those projects and start building a package based on those objects that are in the OMW projects. As part of that flow of building and deploying packages, it will also allow you to transfer OMW projects, and that can also involve actual transfer of objects between path codes. So you can have a selection status for a PY build, and then as part of the Pac-Man flow, Pac-Man will pick up those projects and transfer the status of those projects to a next status, which can involve then the transfer of the object between the development path code and the prototype path code. Then Pac-Man will also know about the enterprise servers that need to be included in the build of a package. So it will automatically select those enterprise servers and build and deploy to those enterprise servers that have been selected for the path code for which the package is going to be built. If in the projects also business services exist, Pac-Man will automatically also build a business services with the package and deploy that business services to the business services instance that has been assigned to the path code for which the package is being built. Because you're automating the whole process, but you still need to be in control, you need to be informed about the whole process, Pac-Man creates summary and details reports that can be sent as notifications to the CNC persons, or but also to end users. And the end users here, we mean the people that need to know about the fact that packages are being built and deployed. And you can do that by path code. Because the so that the developer knows that he that a package was built for the development path code, but he may not need to know about the package being deployed to PD. So you can differentiate between the different path codes in the notifications. As part of the package build process, logs and reports are created both with the JDF, its tooling itself for building and deploying packages, as well as with the process and the flow that Pacman is going through. And all those logs and reports are attached to a Pacman record. And this Pacman record can be shown in a dashboard, and all these logs are conveniently attached to that Pacman record, so you can from one interface that is also available on the web, and you can see all the logs that are built with the package. So you have one interface to look at the details of a package build, the compile reports, everything is there. The tool itself is built with the JD Edwards toolset. So as the package gets delivered to you, it will only contain JD Edwards objects. It is really working as a shell around the existing tooling for building packages in JD Edwards. But it does not interfere with the objects themselves, so no objects get changed. So the standard process still works, but we're calling the APIs and the reports from within the Pacman tool. So for example, when we do the OMW transfers, we're using the APIs for OMW transfers in Enterprise One. So all the functionality of a transfer will also be executed using Pacman, and all the logging that you see in OMW logging will also be there. So here is an example of the process flow that runs in Pacman, and like mentioned, the Pacman tool will select the projects based on a package, will then do a transfer. But there's also, at the end, the possibility to transfer based on the result of the package. If the package build fails, you can have a separate status that the projects are moved into. For example, if the development package fails, it's usually caused by a programming error in one of the objects, and then the project is transferred back to the status that the developer can again pick it up, and you can with the notifications also send a message to the developer stating what was wrong with the package build, so he can pick up the error and fix it and put the project back into the status for selection into the next scheduled package. Also, you do not have to process the whole flow in one go. You can also split up the process in multiple parts. So for example, if you have a really tight schedule for deploying packages, let's say at 10 o'clock in the evening, and you only have like 15 or 30 minutes to do the deploy, you cannot waste the time of building the package in the same time. So what you can do is prior to that deployment window that you have, build the package, and then have the process stop, and then schedule a deployment of that package at the time that the service window is available for a deployment. Every time a flow stops, even when there's an error, or when you stop because you have set the package to only build and not to deploy, reports are generated, as well as when the deployment is done, and those reports will be sent to a CEC person that will give details about how the package build was, if there were errors, if there are any comments about the package, and gives a detailed report about the projects and objects that are included in the package. So let's have a look at the demo and do an actual package build with the tool so I can explain how this works. For the demo, I'm going to use, let me switch to the environment, a deployment server based package build schedule. You can run Pacman from either the deployment server or a Fed client that you have assigned to do the package builds. But since the package build process in JD Edwards is still a local facing process, we have the applications run also locally. The application for Pacman is available on the web, but with limited functionality, so you cannot start a package build from the web. You need to do that from a Fed client or from an from the deployment server. I'm signed on to the DEP 910 environment, and we're using a 9.2 tools release here. Let's first go to the Pacman dashboard application, which will show you all the packages that have been built. So because the automated build is not something that is really fun to see when you do a demo, because it's just starting a process and it will do all the processing itself in the background. What we'll do is we'll use the dashboard to go through the package build step by step. And while we're doing that, I can explain a little bit about what Pacman does. So I'm building for the PD path code. For the PD path code, I have configured Pacman to select all the projects in status 22. So if I'm going to OMW, I can see if I have any projects that are already in status 22 and are therefore selected in the package that I will start. And I have three projects here waiting to be built into a package. And these have multiple objects, including versions and all kinds of objects. By the way, with the Pacman tool, and you're maybe using UDOS, the user-defined objects, also Pacman will do the transfers of the UDOS projects alongside with the transfer of the traditional projects. So you don't need to go to the web to do the UDO project transfer separately from the transfer of the traditional object OMW projects in a Fed client or from the deployment server. So we have three projects. My next step, and that would be the first step in the process of the Pacman flow, is to create a package record. So I will be just entering the path code in this screen, and it will automatically assign me a package name. And for the package name, you can use a naming convention. And in this case, I'm using the convention to use the first two characters of the path code for which I'm doing the build. So that's going to be PD. The last character of the parent full package that I'm that currently is the deployed full package, which is the C package, the FC package, the date, so the month and the day, and a sequence character. So since this is the first package for today, it starts with an A, and so I can have like 26 other packages a day for one path code, which should be sufficient. I click OK. And then I have a new Pacman record, and again in the background the automated process will do that automatically. And I have some row exits that I can use to step through the process that Pacman automated process would do in the background. So my next step would be to select the projects for that path code. And like I said, the selection is done based on the status 22, and I have three projects. If I look at the projects that are currently selected, they're none. So my next step would be to select those projects, and in the background, it is selecting those projects. And as you can see, I'm receiving a notification message, an email, that status 20 is now received for this package name. So let's have a look at the notification. So for this is my email client. So for my package PDC0322A, I have in the subject field it reads projects have been selected, and this is an email template that you can assign to a status in Pacman. And it's really an HTML template that can also include, for example, in this email, I'm using the InFocus logo. And you can have different keywords that get replaced when the template is going to be used for that specific package. So the keyword gets replaced with the actual value, so the package name, the status, and the status description. And you can have a table with all the projects that have been selected. Also, reports can be attached to the email, so we'll look at that later. But this is a status email that we have received based on the fact that this package has now reached status 20, projects have been selected. The next step would be to transfer the projects, and this will take the projects and move them to a configured next status that can be like a package build pending status. So it's not in the selection status anymore. It's a new status that will depict that the projects are currently being built. At the end, when the deployment is done, it can be moved to the status the package build has been ready, or it has is now ready for testing, depending on what your description of that status will be. Projects are now selected. If I look in and transferred, if I look now in package projects, I can see the three projects have been selected, and the project status is now in status 23, which was the next status that was configured in Pacman for the PD package. Then I can create a package, and for the purpose of this demo, I'm showing you the summary screen of the package assembly. Which of course will in an automated process not be shown because it will just continue, but for the purpose of the demo, I'm showing you this screen to show you the objects that have been selected into the package. So these are the objects that existed in these three projects. You can add features to a package. So for example, if you want to schedule a full package build as a feature, you can add the web development client to it. If you have installed multiple languages, you can also select multiple languages into your package, which of course you should not forget to do when you do a manual package. And we can see that it's not building any business services. If a business service was included in this package, it would have automatically set that for this package also business services need to be built. So the package is now created. And the next step would be to create the build instructions. So to what enterprise service will the build be submitted and will then be started? So we'll not start the build now, because then we'll have to wait for the build to complete. What we'll do is we'll go back to the OMW projects. Those are now in stage 23. And I can move those back to the selection status again. So I can now show you and explain how the automation of the package builds will be done. So the developer has put these projects back into status 22, so they're now selectable for the package that we schedule. So the scheduling of the package, actually the process that is doing the complete process of building packages is a batch that will run locally on the deployment server or on a Fed client that is assigned to do the package builds. And you can set up versions for the batch, RFZ PM002, which will do the package builds, and use those versions for specific builds. So per pad code, you can set up a version and tell it what to do. Or you can set up multiple versions where one version will do the build and another version will do the deploy. And you can schedule those different versions for this batch separately. Because the batch will need to run locally, you cannot use the One World scheduler at this point, because that scheduler can only run batches on the server, on the enterprise server. But we use a script locally to submit those batches. So you can use either the Windows task scheduler to schedule these tasks, or we do have customers that use more an enterprise level scheduling tool that they use to start backups or even to submit UBEs to the enterprise server. So any scheduling tool that will allow you to start a script on a Windows server will be sufficient to do the scheduling of a package build using this batch. So what do we need to configure for this batch to run? So there are only processing options that you need to configure for a scheduled batch to build and deploy packages. In this case, we're doing a full we're going to run a full flow in Pacman. So we're going from status 10 to status 99 for the path code PD910. So like I said, for another path code you can set up another version, maybe having the same setup except for the path code, and you can schedule that separately. In this case, we're going to send email status updates. You could turn this off if you're testing and you don't want have the automated process send all these emails to the people that have subscribed themselves to the status changes in Pacman. But in general, this will be set to Y. And then there's this status or this option where you can tell the process what to do if an OMW project that's selected into the package fails to transfer. So if you do a PY build and the and as part of the package build, a transfer will be done from the DEV path code to PY. It is possible that one of these projects that are selected into your package will fail to transfer. So the objects will not actually be promoted to PY. And this option will tell the process what to do. If it's set to 1, it will leave out the project that failed to transfer, send a notification about the fact that a transfer failed, and it will continue with the other projects that did successfully transfer to the next status. This will be good for a DV, a PY, or maybe even for an acceptance package, but for a PD package, you may want all the projects that you have put in your production release. And you don't want one of them to fall out of the production release because a transfer fails or there's something wrong with the transfer. And then you can put it to 0, what means that it will also send the notification, but the process will stop. So you get an email stating the production package has stopped because the transfer has failed, and then you can take action to fix the problem and then continue the flow where it left off. And the last processing option is whether this is a full package, yes or no. It's not a full package, we're building an update package here. So this package or this version will start a package in PD. It will pick up those projects in status 22 and start to build and then deploy the package. For the time's sake, we cannot wait for the package to finish, but I'll go back to the dashboard screen and show another package that has already been deployed and show you the different reports that were added to the Pacman record. So let's start let's do that by actually starting the script. So not within JDE, but with using the script to start it. And we have a script that will locally start the batch. So we can see that the batch will be submitted here, and we can see that the RFZPM 002 XJDE 0001 has now been started, and we can also see that we have received again a notification, and for this notification we can see that it has now assigned a new package name because A was already created, not started, but was already created, and now it has selected the package name B. And I can see that those three projects were included in the build. Going back to the while it's building, and you can see that it already has started the R9621S. So the server build side of the package build. Going back to the application, we have now a second project package for today in status 60, meaning build is started. And where I showed you in the beginning of the PowerPoint, all these activities that need to be done to get to the point where you need to, where you can actually start the build. So selecting the projects, the project need to be transferred, then you have to create the package assembly. All these manual steps have now been done automatically. And if we look at the status log, I can see that it has been done within 5 seconds now. So automatically within 5 seconds, the build has been started after we submitted the batch in the background. So this will continue, and if it's possible to deploy, it will deploy the package. That's one thing I need to mention as well. The deployment will only be done, so it is a controlled way in which it will automatically deploy. What it will do is the process will check the enterprise servers if they are available for deployment by checking if there are batches running that can block the deployment. And it will do that for a certain amount in of time with a number of checks that you can configure in Pac-Man. If after that time still batches are running and those batches are not in a list of batches that can be terminated by Pac-Man, so you can set up a list of reports that Pac-Man will allow to terminate when the package build of the deployment cannot start because of those batches still running, then it will send a notification that the deployment is not possible at that moment. So it will never start to do a deployment if batches are still running, because that will possibly lock your server and you will need to do a restart of your enterprise server. If it has found in that same window where it's checking for the batches that a batch that there are no batches running, then it will start to submit the deployment, and the deployment will then be done, and notification will be sent that the deployment can be done, if it was done successfully. So let's have a look at one of these packages that have been built and deployed successfully. And if I go to the attachments, I can see all the reports that are generated as part of this package. So this can include the deployment report that that you typically see when you do package deployments. So these are the JD Edwards based reports, and as well as the business function build logs. So if the package build fails, you can from the web or from the dashboard application see this log and determine what the cause of the package build failure was. But we also create our own reports that will give you information about what the package build has been doing. So we have a version that can be sent to end users, allowing to get informed about the status of the package and what was included, and also if there are any instructions, special instructions that need to be executed, or any notes that developers or consultants have put on the projects. That will be shown here as well. But the detailed report gives more information, and that is specifically used for the CNC personnel to get informed about the detailed status of a package. So it will also show the projects that were included, but also show the status log it has been going through. So you can see the timing of the different steps it was going through, as well as the complete list of the objects that were included in the build. That can be quite a list. The package build status, so for the client build, for the object build, and for the business function build, it will show you the status. If one of these fail, so for example, if the business function build fails, the status will not be 50, And it will, as a subsection, also show the objects that failed to build. So you know what objects have failed to in the build. If the deployment is successful and the deployment is done, it will also show you the status of the deployment. And again, these special instructions or notes that have been put on the as a text attachment to the projects can also be shown in the report as well. This concludes the demo of the Pac-Man solution. So if there are any questions, Mike, can you see if there are any questions that I need to answer here?
Yep, there's several that came in. And folks on the webinar, if you have any others that you can think of before we transition over to self-serve password reset, by all means, fire them into us now. So one of the questions was, how about full packages? So I assume, Junis, that's, can you do full package builds as well?
Yes, so the schedule of a package build, which we started with the batch versions here, if you look at the processing options, there is the option to do a full package build. And for the naming of the full package build, you can also set up your own naming convention to create the package names that you want to use per path code. So you can schedule, build, and deploy full packages with Pac-Man.
Okay, great, thanks. Next one is, what if we need to rebuild the same package again after the object got fixed? Is it the same process that we would use for submitting the packages again?
There are two options. If you have a problem with the package, if it's, for example, a project that does not transfer correctly, then the package without those projects having built and deployed already, but you want to build that failed the project that failed to transfer, and for that you can just put the project back into the selection stage, and the next schedule would pick it up again. If you have a deployment that fails, so because there's no service window in which it can do the deployment, you can just go to the dashboard application, and I do not have a package here in the correct status, but I can change the status of a package to, for example, 80, which means build completed successfully. So now the build is completed here, and I can redeploy the package using this. And the advantage of doing the deploy using the dashboard is that it will still use that same functionality of checking whether the deployment can be done, yes or no, and also that the post transfers of those projects will be executed after the deployment is done.
Okay, great. Thanks. Very thorough answer with a couple of choices. That's what we like. The last one before we continue on to this is, can we use the manual build setup and schedule it to be built and deployed via Pac-Man?
I must, I do not know if I quite understand what that means. So can you repeat the question? Maybe I...
Yeah, it's, can we use the manual build setup or process and schedule it to be built and deployed via Pac-Man?
Well, actually, you could do it. We need a Pac-Man record here. So if you want to do a manual setup of your package, and the name exists in the Pac-Man application, then you can do that. So for example, if you start using Pac-Man, you have all these packages that are not listed in Pac-Man. We have a batch that will pick up all your existing packages and add them to the Pac-Man tables, and you can start working from there. So yes, if you, but I in this case, what I would do is I would create the package record by clicking add. So I have a name for the package. And then if I use this name, it will automatically be picked up by the Pac-Man functionality. So it will check in the background what the status is of the client, and if the deployment for Fat Clients is assigned, of what the server deployment status is. So you could combine both the functionalities with Pac-Man.
Okay, great. So, well, if that answered your question, awesome. If there's some follow-up or some qualifiers you wanted to ask on it, just let us know, pop another question in, and we can cycle back to it at the end. One last question that came in, now to this before we continue on. For auditors' purposes, is there any table that we could use to give them, I guess, to be able to show what's been done?
To what the table, that's Will?
Is there a table that could be used for audit purposes?
Oh, yes. Yes, indeed. So there is the option, even when the, so all this information that's in here. So I have now a selection of records that will show you all the projects that have been built using that package. And what you can do, once you have built a new full package, you would then no longer need the full previous full package and the update packages that you had before. But there is the option to automatically delete all the update package and full package that you no longer need, but leave this information behind. And there are tables that will show you the packages that have been built and the details about what was included in the package, even the status log of what has happened will be shown. So for example, I did change this as a build completed. If I would go in here, you can see that it has gone through this whole flow, and my stage change that I just did is registered as well. And that is all in Pacman tables, and that can be used for auditing purposes.
Okay, great. Thanks. Okay. I think we're ready to continue on to SSPR now.
Okay, good. But we do have a customer benefit slide about Pacman that I just briefly want to go through. So you can, of course, see what Pacman can bring to you is an increase in the process efficiency, because there are manual repetitive activities that are now automated. And because of the way that the package builds and deployments are done, which will be typically in low hours that there's no activity, so that there's typically late hours, so you don't have to do that anymore because you're automating it. You still have access to what is going on your phone by checking the emails that are being sent out. It also improves your service level to the business, because you can now schedule. You don't have to do it yourself. And you can schedule multiple times on a day to check for projects that are in a selection status, which will speed up your development to prototype and from prototype to production process. So it will increase the number of updates that you can bring from development to production. And because of the automation, you schedule, there is logging about the process, and you don't need to do the communications manually by sending Excel sheets or emails from a developer to a CC person to know what the projects are that need to be included in the build, which of course reduces the risk of leaving project behind or errors that are being made in the process. With that, I want to switch to the other subject, that's the self-service password reset. So why would you want to use a self-service password reset? What we have seen, and we've started to develop this tool ourselves because we do have quite a number of managed customers for which we do the CNC administration, including the password resets. Is that with the password resets in JD Edwards, you always need an admin person to do the reset for you, and especially when you have multiple time zones and you have a help desk in one time zone, people need to wait for the password reset to be done, which means that there is end user downtime. They cannot sign on to Enterprise One and do their job. And that causes efficiency loss, of course. So with the tool, you will increase your help desk efficiency. They will not have to do any password resets anymore, and improve the end user productivity because they don't have to wait for the password reset to be done. Especially where we've seen the increase of the productivity is where people only need to sign on once a month to do their time entry or any activities that they only do on a periodic basis. Those are the cases where people tend to forget their password more often, causing them to not be able to do that job that they need to do on that time. What we also seen as a side effect of using these SSPR solution is that because they can automatically themselves reset their passwords, the CNC admin or the admin security admins, they could increase the level of security for the password policy. Because what would happen if you increase the password policy to a higher level is that people with the more strict password policy will tend to forget the password that is more complex more often than when the password policy is less complex. And now that they have the option to reset the password themselves, you can also force a stricter password reset policy to be used. So how does it work? You're looking at a Enterprise One sign-on screen. This is an AA12898 password screen. That's just to show that the tool will work from A12 and on in Enterprise One. But what you can see here is that a forgot password screen, if a link has been added to the screen. And if a user forgets his password, he can click the forgot password link, which will bring up this form. And in this form, a user can enter his user ID, which will bring one of the configured questions that a user has populated with a answer that the user only knows. Once the user submits, in the background, the question and answer is submitted to a service on JD AdWords, which will validate and check the question answer, and then will either send an email with the notification or show the password in the form, depending on how your configuration is. So how does that work from an architecture point of view? Because the user has no access to JD AdWords at that point, we need to show or use a form that is outside, working outside of JD AdWords. Because, well, if they want to use a JD AdWords screen, they have to sign on first. So we have a form that we deploy on an Apache web server with PHP enabled. And the submit of the question and answer, or even the fetch of the question, for this a SSPR service will be used. And this is just a bridge between the form and the SSPR logic that is running on the enterprise server. So this is used to get the question, to submit the answer and with the question and the user ID. And the logic really for resetting the password is here. So let's have a little demo to show you, and then I'll also show you what on the JD AdWords side needs to be done, or can you that you can configure in SSPR, and show you some of the features that there are in this tool. And for this, I need to go to a sign-on screen. I'm using the 9.2 with 9.2 tools release as well. And I have the sign-on screen to my development environment. And I see here the forgot password link. So I forgot my password link, my password. So I click the link and it will show me. Did I click it? I did click it. Oh, there it is. And it will show me the form in which I can enter my user ID. As you can see, because I'm here in the Netherlands, the labels are translated into the language of the browser that is being used. But it says reset password, username, question, answer, submit. So what is the brand of your first car? That is one of the questions that are configured for my SSPR profile. And I click send, and the password reset is submitted. So using the SSPR service, the request has been sent to Jaggy Edwards, which will validate the information, and I receive my password using email. So I've just received the password, and here it is. What I can do is I can take the password, go back to my sign-in screen, put in my name, and then paste the password that I just received in my email. And the password reset function also expires the password. So I, as a user, I can re-enter my old password that I just received and type in a new password. That will be the new password that I can use in my future times that I need to sign on to Enterprise One. So I've just reset the password to a password that I know. And now I'm in Enterprise One. And there are a number of applications that you can use to configure the SSPR solution. So SSPR uses its own set of configuration tables that you can secure using Enterprise One. So only an administrator has access to this information. And the only application that a user will need to access is the SSPR work with a profile application, which he will need to access just once to set up his profile. And the set up his profile means he has to select a question and put the answer in and then save that information. So this will allow him to do future password resets. And there is a list of all the users, in this list of users you can see how many password resets have been executed by the users, by the different users. And you can also set a status, whether this user is enabled to do password resets, or he can, or he she can not use the SSPR functionality. The status can be auto-disabled. This means that this user can have multiple password reset failures, which will auto-disable this user to do future password resets. Once a password reset attempt fails, a system administrator that is configured in the configuration application for SSPR will receive a notification that a failed password attempt was being made. So this will allow a system administrator to take note that this has happened, and if it happens again, he can take action, because it might be that a user is trying to gain access or someone is trying to gain access to the profile of another user. Also, the user themselves will get a notification that a failed password attempt was made on his account, and if he did not do that himself, that he needs to notify the system admin. There are also statuses that will just temporarily not allow the user to do a password reset, and that can, for example, be an status because there is year-end processing, you don't want people to sign on and or reset their password, then you can reset the set of status to a different status, so they cannot do the password reset themselves. A password reset attempt that fails will disable the SSPR access, but it will not disable the account in JD Edwards themselves. So a user not trying to gain reset their password will not get disabled because someone else is trying to gain access to his profile. Then there is the question maintenance. The question maintenance is the list of questions that you want the users to choose from, and you can create your own questions that they can choose from. Then there is the setup application itself. It will I want to go through some settings to explain some other features that exist. So one of the features is the profile reminder. If you set up the users to use the SSPR functionality. The end users will still need to complete their profile. They have to go to that application and select the question and the answer combination that they want to use. And you can set up a batch that runs on a specific period of time to check if profiles have not been completed yet. And after how many days, the user will receive a notification that they have not yet completed their profile, and a shortcut to that application will be sent with the email so that they can click it and go directly to the application to set their profile. And also the from email address that is being used by the SSPR application and the administrator email address that will receive the notifications when something fails with the reset, you can set up here. Then some other things that you can set up is the password or the question for the answer length that they need to use, and this is the password reset functionality that is generating a password. It's 10 characters long and it's using alphabet numbers and symbols. You can see the password was quite strange in how it looks, and that is of course because we're sending alphabet numbers and symbols. Also, the way that you want the passwords to be published, email or on screen, we have several options. Email or on screen means that if there's an email address, we'll send it by email and not show it on the screen. If there is if there's no email address, it will be shown on screen. So there is the option to add users for which you do not know the email address, to add them to SSPR. Once a user is adding or changing his profile, he gets also the option to, once, if there's no email address, to populate it. So if you don't know it, you can still assign a user to the SSPR profile, and when the user goes to the profile application, he will get the option to put in the email address. Some other the maximum number of questions that they can configure themselves between 1 and 5. You can just set, okay, a user needs only to select one question and answer combination, and I've set it to 4. So you saw in my profile that I need to populate 4 different question and answer combinations. The emails are based on HTML templates here, and you can put in the subject for 4 different types of notifications that are sent out. That's the password reset email that is being sent when the password has been reset successfully, the reset failed email that is being sent to the administrator and to the user that is trying to do the reset, or for which account the reset attempt was done, the profile reminder email that you can schedule, and a new profile email. When a new profile is entered, you can automatically send an email to that user so that he gets the instruction to set his profile in the SSPR solution. And with this, we are at the end of the demo for the SSPR solution. So Mike, if there are any questions, I think we still have some minutes to answer those questions.
Yeah, we're doing real good on time there, too. No questions have come in to this point in time. So if you wanted to switch back over, I know you've got some wrap-up stuff. Maybe we can see if there's any questions from anybody on SSPR or on Pac-Man while we are going through this.
Yes, so for SSPR, we also have the SSPR reporting functionality. There are 2 reports. One is showing and the summary of what has happened in the last period that SSPR has been used. And there is a report that's doing the synchronization of users that are in Enterprise One to the SSPR solution. So you don't have to enter those users yourself. It will pick up the addresses from the address book that is set in into the account for JDE, and it will upload those to the SSPR solution. So you can have an automatic process adding users to SSPR and even removing or disabling users from SSPR if those users are disabled in Enterprise One as well. So that will really help you to set up all your users if you have a lot of users in Enterprise One. So what we've seen customers report to us is that they have really seen an increase in help desk efficiency, because a password reset can take as much as 15 minutes to half an hour if they need to communicate with the user back and forth. So that is time that they do not have to spend anymore with the end user. So it also improves the end user productivity, because they can do it themselves and can be done within a minute. So that will make them have more access to the application. Because it's an automated process, it's also available 24/7, 365 days a year, which will allow you to do passwords resets around the clock, so to say. It has also enabled a more complex password enforcement. And using the JDE security, you can set up that only the end user will have access to that account, and that only the admin will be able to make administrative changes to the setup. And we have the audit reporting function allowing to see how many password resets you have automated in the period that has passed. And that's for that is for me the end of this session. So, Mike.
That's great. Thanks, Dennis. Just a little bit about Team Kane as the host for it. We've been partners in the JD Edwards space for over 20 years now. A number of upgrades. If you've been to any of the Collaborator in Focus conferences the last couple of years, typically we've had one, two, or three customers presenting on their upgrade experience, their lessons learned, BI publisher, user-defined objects, and all that as part of that. So implementations and migrations, new features and functionality. We've got a client that's actually presenting at Collaborate coming up next month on their code turn strategy. Done an awful lot with customers of late on user-defined objects, or UDOs, and all the benefits that you can get from that, things to watch out for, because there are a few pitfalls in there as well. Project management. We are specialists in BI Publisher, and we've got a very specific offering, which is pre-built BI Publisher, very advanced capabilities, particularly around things like purchase orders, invoices, sales orders, payroll notifications and all, and some extensions if you're running in a multi-company, multi-bank environment. So what we've seen on the right-hand side about the main things that we're working with clients these days, 9.2 upgrades, bunch of fixed asset implementations, a lot upon user the UDOs, sorry, losing my words here. Development, finance, UPK assistance, several projects on manufacturing, so MRP, getting it up and going, co-turn projects, and BI Publisher. So we also have partnerships with best-of-breed organizations, much like Forza, and I would be very remiss. We've talked about a couple of the awesome solutions from Forza. There's another one. If you were looking at doing anything on the AP automation side, there's a product called ScanMan, which we've implemented in conjunction with Forza at a number of clients. So if you're looking to get some efficiency there with an Oracle validated integration solution for AP automation, I'd love to talk to you about that. So thanks, Tunis. We can get on to, I think, probably the last slide. Boom! There we go. So as you know, Collaborate is coming up. Both Forza and Team Kane will be there. So mentioning about fixed assets, Hamilton Telecommunications is presenting on their journey to implement it there. I mentioned about Roy Jorgensen. We've got a session as well from a client on upgrading to 9.2, the good, the bad, and the happy dance. And Tunis, I know there's a number of sessions as well that Forza is doing.
Yeah, so we have a session about a World to Enterprise One migration that we did at Casio. That is a 9.2 A73 to 9.2 upgrade that we have done. And the other two sessions are about our ScanMan solution. So we have an implementation done at RioCan that is presenting with us about the success of their implementation and how they have seen the ScanMan solution improve their AP processes. And the other session is about ScanMan as well.
So awesome. And we will both have booths there. So we'll look forward to hopefully seeing some of you on it. So I think, we're just past the hour. So thank you, everybody, for taking the time. We hope this has been helpful for you. Anything else that you think of in terms of questions, feel free to reach out to us afterwards. We will be popping a message out to each of you. That'll include the offer to get a link to the recording. If you want that itself, maybe a copy of the presentation itself, if that would be beneficial. As you are on your way out, do remember that there is the survey if you want to help us out and give us your honest feedback. Cool, that'd be great. Other than that, thank you very much for your time this afternoon. Hope the rest of your day goes well. And tuners, thanks again for another great presentation on PacBan and on SSPR. Thanks, everybody. You're welcome.